Thank you, Sydney High. Our next speaker is a man who I had the pleasure of meeting before this meeting. He's been in vocational education for a long time, but more important, he's very proud of it. Now I'd like to present to you President of Utah Technical College, J.L. Nelson.
Thank you very much, Gary. Last summer, I was in Atlanta, Georgia, attending a vocational education conference. While there, I had the opportunity to visit several area vocational centers. At one of them, I held a discussion with the Dean of Instruction and promised to provide him with some information before I left Georgia. I forgot about it until the morning I was ready to come home. Then I recall, so I picked up the telephone directory, looked up the number of the school, and dialed it. I was quite surprised when the operator's voice came in on the line, and she said, "That'll be 60 cents, please." Well, I was in a rather joking mood that morning, and I said, "60 cents? In Utah, we can call Helen back for 60 cents. And she said, "In Utah, sir, that's a local number." I'm sorry that we didn't have the opportunity to hear during this convention the Honorable Edith Green from the U.S. House of Representatives here from the great state of Oregon. She is, as many of you know, a great proponent of vocational and technical education. We had the opportunity in Utah last summer to listen to Representative Green at a conference which I attended. And I recall she had just concluded a statement reference to dissent and violence on campus. Is that my time? And following this comment, the reference to dissent and violence, she paused, and before going on with her speech, she said, "That reminds me of the college president who died, and he went to hell." And she said, "The tough part about it was, he was there for 4 days before he realized he was on campus." Well, in contemplating the problems that beset educators, it's often consoling to learn that most of our problems have been experienced by others before. And so it was with the scholars and philosophers in ancient times. They too grappled with such questions as state support of education, vocational versus liberal education, and curriculum methods. They even had a toehold on our newly revived old guru, institutional accountability. Now, you really didn't think accountability was unique with this dispensation, did you? But all our predecessors did was to ignore it or talk about it in the hopes that it would go away. Periodically, accountability gets a shot of adrenaline, and it comes charging back. So whether we can apply the biblical axiom, "This too shall pass away," remains to be seen. You know, teachers and pupils weren't so numerous 1,000 years back. But we do have some things in common. This is the way Socrates rapped with his best listener about what seems to be relative to accountability. He said, "When you call in an advisor, you should be certain that he is skillful in the accomplishment of the end you have in view." Now, note the word "end" refers to what the student had in view, not the teacher's interview. Now, if some of us have been ticklish about being more accountable, how many of us would be willing to stick our reputable necks out? A good old Protagoras, when he bent the ear of great Socrates with this statement concerning effective and responsible tutoring, a teacher of this sort, I believe myself, I give my pupils their money's worth, more
authority and with holiness. I will pass my life to practice my art. Into whatever houses I enter, I will go into them for the benefit of the sick and further. I will abstain from every voluntary act of mischief and corruption. And I will abstain from the seduction of female and male, of free men and slaves. And then he went on to say, while I continue to keep this oath unviolated, may it be granted to me to enjoy life and to practice the art. Enjoy and respected by all men and all times. But should I trespass and violate this oath, may the reverse be my lot. He laid down some definite criteria there. Isn't that just what we should be doing? Establishing criteria for excellence, testing them, and then working on their solutions. Not too many years ago, I had the unfortunate experience to spend a few weeks in the hospital recuperating from a little heart attack. While I was there, a friend of mine brought me a choice book on philosophy. This book had some real significant tidbits in, and I never forgot one. One said, we're on this earth for such a short period of time. Let's not hurry. Let's not worry. Let's take time to smell the flowers as we go through life. Well, I thought that was just beautiful. So the next morning when my doctor came around, I wanted to share it with him, and I told him about that. And he said, I'd like to illustrate that for you. He said, you know, I come from a line of sailors. My grandfather traveled all across the western part of the United States, and he had to do it by train. But you know, if he missed a train, he didn't get all upset. He knew that he'd catch one the next day, and that's what he did. He said it was a little different with Dad. He traveled by plane. But if he missed a schedule, the whole world hadn't come to an end. Really, it hadn't. He knew there'd be another one coming along in an hour or two. But not you, he said. If you miss one section of a revolving door, your whole day's gone to hell. Now, you're that way too. Someone said the other day, we go through life like we're trying to read Playboy magazine with our lives turning the pages. Well, let's not hurry. Let's not worry. Let's take time to smell the flowers as we go through life. You know, it's just 2,400 years ago that liberal education was supposed to be an end in itself, sought by the elite to ensure the personal intellectual freedom of the individuals who took it, whereas any other education was simply a lowly means to an end, which subordinated the man to a specific skill. Yes, we've come a long ways. Today we have some advantages. We operate on atomic time. Einstein told us things would pick up, and they certainly have. Events today happen faster, much more dramatically. And right now, I see the educational giant in a crouching position, ready to take a quantum leap into a more well-defined direction that will improve responsible, goal-oriented education, vocational education, career education, if you prefer, is absolutely no exception. You know, we aren't unique or alone in our discussions of accountability at this convention. While we have been in session here, the Northwest Association of Secondary and Higher Schools has been holding their convention in Reno, Nevada. I had the opportunity to look at their program. And you know that the subject of every speech are the subject for every symposium for three full days was accountability. Their keynote speech, interested me, it was educational accountability for trade and industrial education. You know, we're actually beginning to communicate, but sometimes I think that our communications go awry. I had my breakdown not too long ago. I came home late at night. Here on my pillow was a note from my wife, and it said,
today, regardless of what time you come in, call 466-7380. Well, I looked at my watch and I thought, this is rather silly. But as I was instructed to do, I picked up the phone and I dialed the number. A rather sleepy voice at midnight said, "Yes?" And I said, "Is this 466-7380? And he said, "Oh, no, it is not." Well, you know, I looked at that note, and I scratched my head. I couldn't think of anything else to say. So I said again, "Are you sure this isn't 466-7380? And in a rather pleading voice, he said to me, "Friend, have I ever lied to you before?" Well, let's take a closer look at institutional and teacher accountability. Have you thought, as I have, just how vague a term accountability really is? You know, we have a lot of rhetorical descriptions about education accountability today. Descriptions such as, it's putting the dynamics of learning in an organized format for the public to understand. Or another one, it's the pattern for the conscious direction of the teaching effort. And on the descriptions go. But when we really attempt to analyze accountability, we find that it simply means having the ability to be accountable. You and I, the institution, and the whole of society. Just turn that word around, and you have it. Indeed, it takes ability to be accountable. That implies a measure of courage, too, which is probably the very reason we've ignored it for so long. You know, the sages of old had that ability. The Galilean had that ability. James, Dewey, Horace Mann had that ability. And many today are equal to their account. So justify the hang-up. Well, I believe it's because we simply haven't had to face up to the issues. The pressures haven't been applied. And therefore, we haven't had to ask ourselves, with any degree of seriousness, just what is our stewardship in this complex educational enterprise? The citizenry and the educators simply have not communicated. Which reminds me of the story of the plumber who wanted to know whether it was safe to put hydrochloric acid in pipes. So one of his friends said, "Well, you can find the answer to that question if you'll write to the Department of Measurements in Washington, D.C. So the plumber sat down and he wrote a letter to the Department of Measurements and said, "Is it safe to use hydrochloric acid in pipes?" Well, after a couple of weeks, he got back this long, lengthy explanation, which said in part, "The efficacy of the method is undeniable, but the specific corrosive residue is incompatible with metallic ferments. Consequently, we'd suggest an alternate method." Well, the plumber read that letter, and then he reread it. He sat down, finally, and he took it out of his pencil and his paper, and he wrote another letter. And he said, "Look, all I want to know is it safe to put hydrochloric acid in pipes?" Well, after a couple of weeks, some fellow back there in Washington got a hold of that letter who had complete empathy, and he knew exactly how to communicate. He wrote back to his friend, and he said, "Don't do it, Mac. It eats hell out of the pipe." Well, I think that my concept of accountability may be quite different than that of many of my colleagues. I believe this. I personally believe that we've had the 3R syndrome with us too long. The 3Rs were conceived and spawned in little red schoolhouses all across this frontier. But the problem was that our educators thought this cute little maxim such a clever model for education that they've been loath ever since to look for new letters to exploit. Well, it's 1971 now, almost 2,000 years since the master teacher softly spoke about three other things. Our individual stations in life. an exhilarating reinforcement election, which would then unfailingly result in the third S, satisfaction. One of man's strongest ends. Service, success, and satisfaction. Well, let's chew on those. Aspects of accountability, such as institutional productivity, curriculum exploration, definition of goals, student feedback, the proof of the pudding stuff, you know. Those are obviously accountability factors requiring a great amount of emphasis. And indeed, it seems that public pressure will soon be brought to bear on us educators to demonstrate the results of these requirements before the legislature allocates resources to support our endeavors. We've had fun doing our little show and tell, but now the public wants us to show, to tell, and to prove. They want to measure the output. But what kind of output? Well, output like, does the student really understand the formula? Can he really speak French after 2 full years? Can he originate a meaningful model worthy of someone's attention? Or is the lesson material internalized? Now I ask you, are these the only outputs we're investing in? Personally, I believe that our accountability transcends these conventions. I believe it encompasses more than curriculum profiles, more than student skills, and more than high job placement statistics, which we offer up to the legislature for budgetary support. Some time ago, we displayed a poster on the campus of Utah Technical College that read something like this. 9 out of 10 people who lose their jobs do so not because of technical incompetencies, but because of their inability to get along with other people. They simply don't know how to serve in the world of work. They don't realize that even though they may be well trained, they can't possibly be successful until they understand that the whole structure of social and economic intercourse is based upon the provision of worthy service. You know, mankind may be a bit hazy on his role and profession in life, but the profession of life is service. It always has been, and always will be. The loud voice of man cries out, serve us, serve us. And the subdued voice of the ages whispers, provide service, and success will be yours. I ask you, what good does it do to give a man his three-dimensional cognitive, affective, and psychomotor training if he isn't parenthetically taught the meaning of service? Which reminds me of the doctor who called his plumber friend at 4 o'clock in the morning. He said, Mr. Plumber, I need some service. You've got to get over here right away. The plumber said, Doc, you realize what time it is? It's 4 a.m. The doc says, of course I know what time it is. I can read. When you need help in the middle of the night, you don't hesitate to call me. Plumber thought for a moment and said, okay, Doc, tell you what you do. You take 3 aspirin tablets, drop it down the bowl, flush it, and call me at 10 o'clock in the morning. Well, I understand that the master teacher was also a master servant, a service-oriented carpenter and teacher. How would you like him to build your house? I think you could count on a great job. He provided service and was therefore accountable. You know, there's a difference between work and service. Plenty of people perform work. But if it isn't the best we're capable of, then that's all it is. Work, not service. Plenty of people are on the payroll, not on the service roll. It isn't service when a cab operator buries 10 tons of trash
beneath 20 tons of filters when he backfills the foundation to a building, knowing full well that you'll have a sinking problem later on. Not to mention the sledgehammer in your hand against that cat operator. It isn't service when an electrician does a shoddy, unsafe wiring job, knowing full well that the circuit breakers will be popping out all over you when later on a heavy load is fed into that system. That's not service, only labor. And it isn't service when a welder spares the rods on a shovel blade that he knows will crack when it hits the first large boulder. Not service, only work. But what about the barber? He says, does that please you? If that isn't exactly the way you want it, please tell me. Or I'd be happy to trim those sideburns a little more. I dare say that that barber has plenty of repeat customers, even with today's hairstyles. Wouldn't it be well to teach our students that integrity, honesty, dependability, and consideration for others will eventually result in a greater volume of business, more rewards? When's the last time that you had a tradesman made you feel like that you were doing him a favor instead of him doing you the favor? When's the last time you had a tradesman clean up after completing a job? And when have you ever heard one say, can I be of further service to you? If you need me, here's my telephone number. Please call. Well, I'm talking about putting a whole man on the job instead of a half man. Shouldn't the student understand his complete service role? I say we're missing the boat if we don't teach it to him. I would like you to listen for a moment to a student who really got this message. Isn't that beautiful? Service is the ennobling principle of life. If 9 out of 10 people who lose their jobs do so because of poor attitudes for service, shouldn't we be stressing this magnificent quality far more than we do? It should be a classroom credo, the solvent with which the brain should be lubricated. When we think of vocational education, we usually regard it as training somebody to be occupationally proficient. I submit that this is not adequate training. A democratic society demands that its citizens develop personal, social, and civic competence as well. And service is the explicable requisite to attaining that competence. Well, the second S for success may not seem to warrant special emphasis, because it rather tends to be an end in itself. But again, I feel that our schools ought to be making more with it and being more concerned about it because of the 90% fail ratio which we previously mentioned. Personally, I'm a great believer in luck. In order I work, the luckier I seem to be. You've all heard individuals of renown say that success is 90% perspiration and 10% inspiration. Yes, success is wanting something bad enough to work for. You know, some genius once said that success is the proper ratio between what one contributes and what one derives from life. Success
is the proper ratio between what one contributes and what one derives from life. That's why I positioned it between service and satisfaction. It receives from the one and gives to the other. You know, when the Creator fashioned this creature, he expected him to succeed. Man wasn't meant to fail, but to succeed. And also, as this creature fashions his earthly devices, he too expects them to succeed in their function. Yes, it's true. Success has to be experienced. But the more we know about it, the more likely we are to experience it. As that old saying goes, nothing succeeds like success. You know, perhaps a course in human engineering ought to be as important a part of our curriculum as physics is for electronics. We teach a fascinating class at Utah Tech. It's called Zoom, Z-O-O-M, Zoom. This class is designed to teach the principles of generating successful, confident attitudes through reinforced achievement. And we're hoping to lower the fail rate of our graduates by teaching them more about success techniques. Enough third S for satisfaction. It requires the least amount of comment. Suffice it to say that it must unfailingly and inevitably follow its two forerunners, service and success. Service is gratifying. Success is sweet. But satisfaction is satisfaction. That which gives us pride having served and succeeded, and which moves us on to serve and succeed again. You will recall that even Hippocrates expected satisfaction upon his providing the services, which he alluded to. Remember, he said, while I continue to keep this oath unviolated, may it be granted to me to enjoy life, the practice of the art, respected by all men in all times. Many years ago in Greece, there was a man who knew all the answers. He was called Euripides. It was his responsibility to advise the citizens of Greece. But in those days, as today, there were many young men who didn't believe that Mr. Anthony knew all the answers. So one day, the young man decided to they were going to fool the old philosopher. No matter what he said, one of them said to his friend, I'm going to fool him. Doesn't matter what his answer is. His friend said, how are you going to do that? He said, I'm going to the oracle, and I'm going to hold a small bird in my hand, and I'll say, Mr. Oracle, tell me, is this bird dead, or is it alive? If he says it's dead, I'll open my hands, the bird will fly away, and you'll be wrong. And if he says it's alive, I'll crush it with my hand. And again, you'll be wrong. Sounded good. So the two young men scattered the birds. Walked up to the oracle and said, Oracle, tell me, what do I hold in my hand? The wise old gentleman could see the feathers sticking out of the boy's fingers. And he said, why, my son, you have a bird. Yes, I do have a bird in my hand, Mr. Oracle. Tell me, is this bird dead or is it alive? The wise old philosopher, without hesitation, said, that, my son, depends upon you. My colleagues and friends of vocational and technical education, accountability is the major challenge of our time. And success in meeting this challenge depends upon you, and you, and you, and me. Good luck.